Research. discourse.
Thank you.
Indonesia ICPO, and ethnic discrimination is not acceptable for the democratic Indonesia. Has become widely shared in the society.
I see. I see. Increasing.
So the point is that China has escalated its position. During the 2000s, China has tried to change a bit more assertive public diplomacy first to the neighboring countries. And Indonesia has drastically changed to accept promoting Chinese culture from inside. So this has been a big coincidence. And then after that, after the social Obama Indonesia administration, Indonesia-China relations had developed remarkably. In remarkably, not only defense, security cooperation, economic trade cooperation, investment, and here in 2005, the two governments signed an agreement of the Chinese language institutes. So they agreed to establish the Indonesian government agreed to open Indonesian Chinese language institute inside Indonesian universities in 2005. Then after that, Indonesian government, military, and Ministry of Education tried to take a step to implement this agreement, but it took years. Since 2006, 2007, 2008, informal efforts were done, both by the ministry and by the Chinese embassy. But during the second half of the year 2000, informal efforts were done, but it did not come to be materialized very quickly or very fast. That's why in 2010, the two governments agreed a climate action program. Here, after this climate action was signed, the steps began facilitating. And then after that, further accelerated comprehensive strategic partnership. And then, here, this is a statement of 2015, the joint statement strengthening comprehensive strategic partnership between China and Indonesia. And in Section 28, it is noted that the Indonesian side commended the important role of Confucius Institutes in promoting the Chinese language. It is a special. It was noted here. So during the 5 years, since 2010, or at least 2011, up to 2015, there's been some remarkable progress in institutionalizing the Chinese language education here inside the Indonesian universities. Okay, so I just think that the 4 points, the process of this election field, new trends, new features of Chinese public diplomacy soon, perhaps among Mandarin first. And then I made a comparison with other countries last year afterwards. I try to pick up in 4 points. One is the process of opening the institution, and the second is managing and networking of the Mandarin. The third point is a content of education, including extracurricular activities. And the fourth point is the relation with the local Chinese, Indonesian associations, local business associations, local community. Okay. This is the background information of the economic relations. Now, China is the number one trade partner of Indonesia since 2009. And it means that China keeps investing. And China is investing in joint venture corporations. And so Indonesia is a very important strategic partner of trade relations. So eventually, education program of Chinese to promote the highly skilled Chinese language experts and promoting the trade relations will be all part of promoting advanced relations, diplomatic relations between the countries, economic relations. And then here, there are six Mandarins in Indonesia, and I visited the 4 places. I visited the 3 places, and the others I tried to get the information indirectly through the internet. initiative came from Hamba, and then goes to
we ensure snack was made first.
For this country, in 2009, very earlier than the cases in Indonesia.
Really different.
But what is different is this SINAC is directly under the supervision of the Council of Ministers. This is the most powerful ministry. Most powerful ministry in Cambodia. Directly, it means, you know, SINAC is directly under this Council of Ministers, and this Council of Ministers can make a decision, or nationwide make a decision. So, what has been institutionalized since then? The very first is a shift. It started from single institute first. But just in 5 years, they made the 26 local university network. Not only that, SINAC made a provincial institute inside the parliament. Then they had parliament and inside the military. And then China has provided a radio program and a computer China friendship program. And this SINAC is managed. So, what can I say? You know, SINAC is directly under the state control and it directly controls, you know, all kind of, you know, provincial institute. It has expanded so massively under this, you know, a council of ministers. This is so, not that kind of, you know, transnational network kind, like such as the case of Indonesia, but directly under the government of Cambodia itself. This is very different. Actually, another different case is Vietnam. This is, in another way, this is very different, but here, I think, how different. So, you know, in ASEAN countries, actually, China's public diplomacy takes a different shape, depending on the host countries. This is one point. Okay, the content of education in Chinese language, first of all, but at the same time, there is Chinese culture. But here, the culture is, as far as the state diplomacy is concerned, it is mostly focusing on the very ancient traditional culture only, such as Tai Chi or Chinese cuisine, or calligraphy only. And no contemporary movies, contemporary culture are not included. It is a panorama of cultural industries. Okay? But here, please, this is the upside is the Confucius Institute in Thailand. Okay, you know, sometimes the building itself being presented in Chinese traditional culture. You see, this is a Chinese style of Phuket University here. There's a Confucius is also in a kind of, you know, poet views. Okay, an extra curricular opportunity, they teach a number of other institutions. They want to teach, for instance, in the case of Surabaya, a Chinese volunteers want to teach to the, you know, I wrote, flight attendants, or medical doctors, civil servants such as police officers, Indonesian Navy, because Surabaya has Navy, Indonesian Navy, or Indonesian officers based in Surabaya. In Kanjungpura, Pontianak, Chinese volunteers go outside the campus and teach the Chinese language to the private companies, joint ventures of China and Indonesia. So they have one purpose of teaching Chinese language. That's what I think I should. And there are some other annual regular events, cultural events, held by Professor Bahasa Mandarin. So I have to conclude many of studying Professor Bahasa Mandarin for Indonesian students. I think at least, you know, I think there are two merits that are very visible. One is opportunities to study Chinese language from the native speakers. Apparently, this is a good opportunity. The other is opportunity to obtain Hanban scholarship. You know, I heard when you apply for the master program, you have to pass the Han Yushu Kaoshi and Chinese Provincial Test W4. And then you need a recommendation letter from the Professor Bahasa Din, and you was told. I have to confirm this to Professor Yajin later. Okay. But so far, I have an impression that this Hanban led Chinese public diplomacy seems, seems not to avoid, but seems not to focus on the ethnic Chinese communities in Chinese students won't hold the whole and they do not take any regular or strong contact with the Chinese communities that have been embedded for centuries there in some ASEAN countries. And that is my impression. So, one of the Confucius Institute by ethnic Chinese Indonesians complained, look at here, you know, Kanjipura, and one of the ethnic Mataki, you know, Mataki, the imaginist thing, Adama, Confucius English, based in Japan, Kuntianak, other branch. And here, you know, this Mataki said, they criticize this Sakosa Mataki. Their content has nothing to do with the Confucius. So they should not, they are simply making use of the Confucius only. So we don't want to have any contact with them. You know? They are against them. So, because they are not serious. They are not serious in teaching Confucianism. Only using the name of Confucius only, just as a symbol. So they do not have any good reviews in Kajou, Pontianak. Okay, but in Indonesia, I want to say, there has been ethnic Chinese culture already, well before China started public democracy. So China has, Indonesia has its own Chinese culture as a kind of various diversity, cultural diversity. And some nationwide Chinese organizations have their own scholarship, no? For younger generation. And this is in Sat Bahasa Mandarin, yeah. Sat Bahasa Mandarin, in the Liberalist Nukurimada,
studying China and getting master degrees and came back to Sat Bahasa
in here also, there are two of the three Indonesian teachers, I think, studying in China, I think they're getting their masters. So I think, though only a bit, new effect on this sub-Saharan pandemic has been emerging. So, what will be the future? Maybe in the 10 years to come, I think. This is very funny, isn't it? It's too soon to say, to make any definite evaluation, because the impact of evaluation takes years or decades, I think. But, because in Asia, young generations have multiple access to information. So we cannot say that a state diplomacy only can make an effective impact to a young generation, because younger generation have multiple choices, options, and it's because of that, positive actions, but in the future, I think this positive stance, cannot take just for granted, because if China takes offensive actions with regard to the vision of water, then this positive image can turn to some critical comments against China. It is possible. So the public diplomacy, success or failure, I think it's a bit too soon to say. But at least what I can say is that the emerging change has been a new development has been emerging as a consequence of this public diplomacy. That's all what I can say. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Motoko Suto, for the presentation. Yang disampaikan banyak hal seputar diplomasi, khususnya terkait dengan keberadaan pusat bahasa Mandarin di Indonesia, termasuk yang ada di UN. Barangkali tadi juga mendengar kata-kata yang belum familiar, ada istilah hamban yang disebut oleh Profesor Motoko Suto. Hamban itu adalah istilah dalam versi bahasa Cina dari Confucius Institute Headquarters, jadi pusatnya Confucius Institute. Dan saya juga belum mengklarifikasi, di seluruh dunia cenderung disebut Confucius Institute, tapi untuk di Indonesia itu dilakukan penyesuaian. Dan kita menggunakan istilah yang diminta oleh pemerintah Indonesia, tidak Confucius Institute, tapi diubah menjadi pusat bahasa Mandarin. Jadi kalau kita melakukan komparasi begitu, ini barangkali mirip dengan kalau dari negara Indonesia, kita kan juga sedang melakukan diplomasi bahasa dan budaya. Itu dari Badan Bahasa, kan? Badan Bahasa. Ini Badan Bahasa Pusat di Jakarta di bawah Kemendikbud, itu posisinya mirip dengan hamban yang dimiliki oleh China, Confucius Institute. Jadi topik kita itu topik bahasa budaya, dan itu sangat bertalian erat dengan politics. Jadi itu kita perlu paham bahwa di Asia sendiri itu ada dinamika. Topik kita kan Asian Dynamics gitu ya. Secara khusus kita bawa ke kulineri. Untuk kali ini kita mendasari dengan diplomasi secara umum, dan tadi juga ada disebut ada soft power, diplomasi yang terkait dengan soft power, kadang juga disebut soft power diplomasi. Soft power diplomasi di dalamnya itu ada budaya, dan topik kita khusus tentang kulineri itu bagian dari budaya ini yang sebenarnya. Motoko Suto itu mendasari dari yang kita bahas di One Asian Energy Series. Jadi mohon itu bisa di apa ya, dikait-kaitkan. Kita sebagai mahasiswa itu kan seperti customers begitu kan, dari berbagai sumber kita tulaan istilahnya, dan kita sendiri memasak. Jadi masing-masing nanti bisa menjadi chef Marika, chef Juna, chef siapa? Yang satunya lagi? Kalau yang dari UM ada chef Agus. Kalau yang seksi chef siapa? Kita belanja banyak bahan untuk memperkaya bahan yang kita masak dalam otak kita, termasuk yang dari Prof Motoko Suto. Saya yakin ini banyak memberi format bagaimana kita melihat, termasuk yang ini kan dari berbagai jurusan, ada juga dari bahasa Inggris gitu. Biasanya kalau ditanya, kenapa ambil bahasa Inggris? Karena bahasa Inggris bahasa internasional. Sahabat itu mari kita kritisi. Sekarang ini ada juga dinamika lain dari negara Cina itu memiliki move yang sebenarnya proses modernisasi dari yang sangat masif dan juga nuansanya lebih agresif sekarang ini. Jadi itu kita perlu juga sadari situasi-situasi ini yang terjadi di seputar Asia. Jadi itu bagian dari Asian dynamics. Jadi itu situasinya, mohon ini bisa menjadi bagian dari kesadaran kita, kesadaran sebagai orang Asia. Dan berikutnya ini adalah Q&A session. Jadi sebelum itu barangkali Pak ada sesuatu yang ingin disampaikan. Ya, kalau tidak langsung saja silakan yang ada pertanyaan. Kita dulu Pak Nathan.
Ya, yang colorful pink, I don't like the nerve. Nama sama jurusan dan fakultasnya.
Thank you for the time. My name is Latifa. I'm from Mathematics Education. The University of Malang. Here I want to ask about, as we know that the role of diplomacy is exchange and bringing the goods. And what China has done to promote the local goods instead of the bilateral or multilateral relationship? I mean, instead of the China still has a strong character to the society. What China has done to promote the local good? The Chinese choose the local good instead of the bilateral relationship. And then the second, as we know that nowadays, there are a huge population in China, and what is the role of public diplomacy to solve this problem instead of technology development?
Maybe
okay, starting from the second point, let me ask you know, in any statistical data, any geographic size or population or GDP, not per capita, but GDP as a whole, any means, you know, China statistically, no comparison with any other country, every single country, no other country, no? In India, I mean, well, in terms of GDP, yeah, US GDP is to exceed by far, much more. No other country, and if China spends massively to spend, you know, finances, public diplomacy, and uses it to state media, and just to promote Chinese discourse, then it's very difficult, you know, to somehow challenge or protest. It's not easy because we have a global network. But what I can say is that, you know, I think, you know, normative values should be the core of the discourse. And the discourse, you know, if one side is somehow distorting the discourse, then, you know, ASEAN countries somehow should be united. And if united, it will become a very strong physical power. And, you know, so if from now on, for the coming 10 years, because it's a one-party system, it's a one-party system, it's a very strong power, economic and military power. If it takes a decision, military action, then I think, you know, no single country can stop it. And no single country can make its effective public diplomacy unless they're united. United, I mean, the regional solidarity would be a very significant means and approach for any country of the ASEAN country. So ASEAN should be more strengthened than ASEAN, Indonesia, but in particular should take initiative in making, elaborating the quality of governance of ASEAN. And then, I mean, you need to develop a good relations with all neighboring countries, you know, India, China, Australia, US, and all. But not just being sided or being overwhelmed with one power only. And so I think ASEAN should be elaborated. And for that Indonesia, I think there's much that Indonesia should do, and only Indonesia can do. And your future purpose for the coming 10 years is enhance the moral capacity and quality of governance of ASEAN, and Indonesia is crucial. This is my answer to the second question. And the first question of the local ethnic Chinese, you know, the public diplomacy. Well, you know, in a sense, with regard to the China state public diplomacy, local ethnic Chinese ethnic communities do not pay much attention. The same with the Malaysian. Malaysian ethnic Chinese community do not pay attention much to this Chinese public diplomacy. Even so, they do not have any courses provided this. Well, in a practical purpose, you know, China needs a counterpart in promoting its massive project or economic and trade relations. From now on, as you know, public funding, massive infrastructure project, in order to make deals, what China needs is contact first with a kind of relationship with Chinese group leaders. This is what happened to Malaysia already. Have you ever heard of the East Coast Rail Link? The East Coast Rail Link? Or Malacca? Malacca? You know Malacca, how it is, you know, of course. But, you know, State of Malacca have signed an agreement with the Chinese State Corporation to make an offshore, reclamation of offshore island, to make a new island there, offshore Malacca. So, you know, what's going on now is not only in the inside of the South China Sea there. South China Sea, China reclaimed, China made an artificial island there, saying that it's not for military purpose, it's just for humanitarian purposes, as I said. But now, apparently, they make military equipment there, you know, the railway. So, Secondly, discourse can be changeable, can be changeable, changeable over the time. My colleague said this is just for the trade purpose of it. But anyway, state of Maratha government is very happy. Okay, now we have more fun. Chinese State Corporation will make a big infrastructure there. So in this way, you know, in order to conclude a massive project agreement, maybe in the context of the massive infrastructure project, and then China need a counterpart. And all in all, China need good contact. So that is one purpose. So maybe we need more good relations with the Chinese community. And but this has nothing to do with state public diplomacy. State public diplomacy will contribute to enhancing the communications by providing the very efficient translators and workers in Chinese corporations. So maybe in the 10 years to come, you know, all this public diplomacy and its outcome will become a very effective and cooperative part of this joint venture, ASEAN-China infrastructure project. And all in all, so maybe local ethnic Chinese, if not all of them, but part of the very influential leaders will be part of this all ongoing process. I wonder if I answer the first question, or if I misunderstand the question, just maybe not. I will try to answer that one. Maybe if I misunderstand the question.
Any other questions?
Thank you for the time. My name is Cynthia. I just want to ask, nowadays we know that the competition among the countries has begun, but one of the statements of China's public diplomacy is do well to our neighbor, treat them better, make them secure, and then help to make them rich. How can Chinese people of Republic of China believe this kind of statement? Yeah, instead of the competition has begun, how can we become number one, for example, by doing the strategy? Make our neighbor rich. Like that. Thank you.
You know, I myself have many Chinese graduate student from the Chinese government, Minister of Foreign Affairs. And personally, they are very nice people, serious, and very nice. So, you know, in terms of the personal relations of the younger generations or government officials, they are very nice people. But in terms of the state apparatus, it is very strict, getting strict, you know. In China, the state organizations, it's getting very tough these days. So, in the universities, you know, and if they say, university professor has to be very careful what to say, what should not be said, because they are making some cameras inside the room. So my point is that, you know, rhetoric and the real actual relations, you know, the personal relations, you know, some the real individual relations, that is very good. But once, you know, state apparatus, state decision that is made at the top of the Communist Party, okay, we make a decision, we do this, we take this way, then this rhetoric can be changed. So, we make our neighbor rich, we make a win-win relation. Okay, we, ASEAN China, we are destiny community. This is what the President Xi Jinping said, destiny community, and win-win relations. They are very beautiful, and they are fine, nothing wrong. But, you know, be very careful. Realistically, implementing policy with decision makers and decision can be suddenly changed, somehow unpredictable change. And at the very top of the decision makers, so then rhetoric can be somehow be adjusted to change. So, unpredictability is one problem. And the other thing is that, you know, rhetoric, in a sense, you know, is a power election. Power election that is somehow asymmetrical. Those who have power to buy, to fund, finance, those who need the finance, you know? This is not the kind of equal basis. So actually, the real asymmetrical power relations can be very cleverly concealed by, say, distinct community. So what they can say, yeah, hey, it depends on the context. But individually, it's very good to have a good individual relations. It's very good, important. But state-state or institutional or more higher power relations, they are something unpredictable, really unpredictable. And it's a kind of harsh power relations. That is.
My name is Prof Motoko Suto. I'm taking Masters in Education. I have like two questions.
Two questions.
Okay. One, basing on the Chinese public diplomas, how would you about the negativity, because now we see Chinese diplomat is Chinese as Chinese countries is fighting to be in those countries which have low economy so as we can control them. For example, taking though you're talking about Asia, but I can refer an example from Africa. There is a country like Zimbabwe where their economy is very low, but is trying to be there to introduce its own issues so as it can make the country to be rich, but in terms of indirect way, is trying to kill the culture of all Zimbabwe. But introducing Chinese, that is that a diplomat or it is the way of killing the poorest countries? But the second, but small, sorry, it is all about the trust. We trust. When we are talking about the diplomats, we have to trust each other. But most of whom, majority of people, when they hear about the product from China, any products, they term it in the fake. It's a fake product because they last for short time. What do you say about this? Thank you.
True. Yes, I am aware of the situation in African countries. Yes, so I can say China has been providing the Chinese aid, let me say, Chinese aid directly, the very fast, quick decision they made. But they just, you know, they made an assistance, economic aid, and the aid is provided to the top leaders who are often the authoritarian leaders. And then after that, you know, Chinese state corporation comes with the Chinese workers, and they bring a China down there in African countries or other parts of Asian countries, and then on the deep place in Africa. So there are much criticism from the local people. They are losing our jobs. They are taking away jobs from us, and I know. So there's it's a very, a cruel situation that Chinese aid has been. But it has, what can I say? Yeah, This is the other side of that Chinese aid. But again, China is providing the public diplomacy to these countries. So, how can I say it? It's a very contradictory situation. Yeah, but but China itself has learned and changed its expression, I think. But still, they don't care much about the transparency or participatory decision-making style, something like this suggests the OECD country prioritized. So actually, a way of providing aid is very different from the OECD country. So this is a negative side of China. So in that sense, China's public diplomacy cannot be so effective as China expected it to be. This is somehow much criticized by China's Tang offensive, which is simply done for the Chinese interest, by the Chinese workers, by the Chinese corporations. As I introduced here, the Chinese public diplomacy is primarily for the Chinese national interest. So it has been criticized here. So a similar thing can be the case in many African countries.
Okay, I think that we have to, because we are out of time, I think that all of you have processed in the 5th and 6th period. So, yes, that's about the Chinese diplomacy in ASEAN, especially in Indonesia, that the prospects are really big. So we can, we have to probably take a look at the big picture before we take a look at the really focus on one thing. As you can see, we have some information, a lot there we can use as well, like the PPM, Pusat Bahasa Mandarin. Normally, setiap semesternya, nanti kalau ingin memang belajar Bahasa Mandarin atau apa, bisa mengunjungi Pusat Bahasa Mandarin. Itu memang mereka membuka course untuk belajar Bahasa Cina di Pusat Bahasa Mandarin, bersama Pusat Bahasa Mandarin. Dan banyak scholarship yang ditawarkan, dan sayangnya mahasiswa OM kurang maksimal memanfaatkannya. Jadi semoga dari OALS mungkin ada yang benar-benar dari One Asia Lectures ini nanti mungkin yang dari Tata Boga atau yang lain punya ide memanfaatkan dari diplomasi pihak Anban Confucius Institute Cina untuk mendapatkan beasiswa belajar sesuatu tentang mungkin kuliner Cina atau apa yang bisa dimanfaatkan. Okay, so I think that's all for today. Sure.
Not too much, but one word. Please let me conclude by saying this, that what I want to say is, China's public diplomacy is the focus of what to portray, but China itself is now somehow confused with its identity, in a sense, because, China is, in a sense, in a lost. What should be its own identity? But, because of the rise of China in such a short period, I think, so they have to somehow be presented to it, positive image. They happen to find the Confucian, as a good token. But, the point is that Communist Party has its political power, and which is intended to realize that socialism, which nobody of the Communist Party believes in anymore. So, the point is that China itself has become poorer identities. What should be the Chinese identity? Political leaders, the populace may be somehow confused. So, but still they have to project its image. So, for you, for future generations, try to see, China has become by far plural societies. The top leaders have a plural, complicated identities. So, for you, study Bahasa Mandarin, try to develop good relations with many countries, Asian countries, and for your future, please try to make a plural perspective, not only one aspect, but please try to have a plural aspect, and remember the importance of the sustainable development goals, and please remember the significant role of ASEAN for future.
So for the ASEAN, the regional government is perfect, because the right of China is something undeniable. But you have to deal with this, you know, dominant power, a predominantly power, which is by far hegemonic in nature. But you have to go deal with them in a most clever, most brilliant way. So for that purpose, please study very well and please develop many good, good relations, international relations with China or other Asian countries as well, and have a very plural perspective.
Thank you, Professor Motoko Suto. Okay, so that's all for today's One Asia lectures about the Chinese diplomacy, especially in ASEAN and Indonesia. So hopefully see you on the next guest lecture, One Asia lecture. But for sure, there will be another lecture next week. I guarantee it. I will let you from Kim. Jadi saya akan membayangkan Anda untuk fokus ke ujian. Nanti setelah ujian mungkin sebelum pulang minggu kedua atau ketiga Desember nanti ada perkuliahan lagi. Sama sekalian kebetulan hari ini tadi karena mendadak sebenarnya untuk seminar kit sudah ada beberapa yang jadi tapi masih belum semua. Jadi masih belum bisa dibagi. Jadi nanti waktu kuliah ketiga ya jangan sampai ketinggalan. Untuk seminar kitnya akan dibagi. Oke, terima kasih. Sampai ketemu di perkuliahan.